So hi everybody and welcome back to a full game tutorial series for absolute beginners. This is video 64 and in this video I want to talk about gameplay again, but let's see the overview. So you can see we are in the section gameplay, and in section gameplay in our last video we talked about this game instance, which is very important when you want to not all time save the game during the game and save it between. So we use the game instance. And in this video, we are talking about gameplay, but especially about the warm sound. And what I mean with this warm sound is, let me start first my game so that I can demonstrate it to you. So I start here my game, I load the game. And then after loading, let's see where we are, because we are continue with gameplay and I won't come to the point where you have to react. Here you can collect a little bit, so you are jumping here.
It's dark. I have to
find the lighter, yes, and then I try to find it and we spawned it randomly here in three positions. Let's see where it is. It is spawned here a little bit later. All right, and then I can collect the lighter. I can later I will also put out the light. I give their later instruction, but this is not right important. Then I can search my pistol, which I accidentally dropped there, but that I make again offline this kind of stuff. This is just gameplay instructions. We talked about this instruction box, but important is now what comes next. Let me make here the sound a little bit more. And now you heard this sound here. Wait, now. Where is it? Where's the sound? So
what was that?
Okay, that was the sound, and actually my microphone can't capture it very nice. The sound is normally good, but when you hear it in game, so important is this sound. That was the warm sound, right? With this this monster warm sound in my case, because like I said, my story here is telling normally a detective who is trying to solve a mysterious vanishing of people, and he thinks that there are cultists and these cultists are trying to kill them, probably something like that. He is guessing that perhaps, but now he is surprised with a strange warm sound, and now we have to use our creativity to make this warm sound possible. And here I stop at this point. Let's press here AST. You can see we can quit here. We can switch here to our level. And this warm sound implementation is actually, there are different ways. What I mean with different ways is because now you can really use your creativity to find a way how you implement this warm sound. But first of all, we have to define what the warm sound really makes and is. For this purpose, save selected, I have to go here. Here's the gameplay. The warm sound is, let me show this. So when you are walking here, the warm sound will start when you overlap again a box. Like old time, you know, we have created these boxes for the instructions. And here is a collision box. And when you are walking over this box, this warm sound comes. And what is the warm sound? The warm sound is this monster worm, like I mentioned here in my short description, which is appearing. And how is this appearing? The monster sound, I will show you how I make it, is appearing with like so. He is under the earth, because that was our theme of this game, as below so above. So the worm will walk under the earth, but important is the worm, in my definition, will only work when you walk, and because the worm reacts on your footsteps waves. With other words, if you walk, your footsteps create waves. The worm locate these waves and moves towards these waves, right? And if you stop, the worm stops too, because then he is trying to locate the new waves, right? This is my implementation, my idea, my creative idea. Now, we have to implement this anyhow, and we have to find a way. I found a way. There are different ways how you can implement this idea. But interesting also is, I want to show you that I will probably create also a sequence in this thing. I want to show this sequence how the worm is coming back from, I don't know, let's say, we go here back here, and then the worm under the earth sequence we make here, something like that. It looks a little bit strange, but it's okay. The worm is under the earth and he is coming like so. We make here a sequence how the worm will come like this later all time, the sound, so that we, that the player can see that something is coming. We will make it in first person perspective, so we don't show the worm. Actually, we don't need the static mesh for this animation, so we need just a camera, but the movement looks really cool, right? So let's say I'm here at this point, anywhere there, and the worm is coming then, I don't know, from here. Every time I walk, we make this sound and the worm makes our step closer to us. And then again I walk and the worm is coming closer to us. And there is a point where the worm is so close enough that he can grab us and kill us and eat us and whatever. So this is so the idea, and the next idea is of course what I have to do. So what is the player doing? So the player here is realizing, okay, every time the worm moves, makes all time the sound before this, the scream sound, worm scream sound, right? And the player realized after, let's say, 2 scream sound, that the scream sound becomes louder and louder, which means the player realized, our detective here, oh, the sound comes closer, which means it is soon at its point. But he also realized at the same time that the sound comes only closer when he walks. And if it stops, the sound comes not closer because it's not there. And then let's make there some smarter detective and say, oh, if I don't walk, the sound comes not closer. And then he has to figure out in gameplay how he can manage to walk in a safe zone or something like that. We have to see this later, so that the worm is not killing him. This we will implement later, the second part. But right now in this video, I want just implement how the worm is creating the sound and reacting to the sound. And what I mean with that is, you can see every time, this is later, I show you this in a moment a little bit more in detail, but let me show you what I want implemented in this video. In this video, every time I move, this is my move input for the character, I will call here a prototype for worm sound. A worm makes a sound every time when I move. After a special interval, the worm will make a sound, and when the worm makes a sound, it means the worm is moving towards you because he realized your step waves. So, and then it will walk towards, and then we have to implement also the interval. So the worm needs, I don't know, you need, let's say you make every 10 steps, then the worm realizes the waves and then what walks towards here, something like that. And then of course the activation point where when the, it was this activation point, because the activation point means of course after you step this collision box here, then this whole worm appears, and then all this kind of stuff counts. And now I will, that was just the fast overview what I want to do, and let's do this a little bit more in detail. So what is that what I want again more in detail? I want that when my character is walking here in, then we heard this scream, this warm sound scream, it is dark, right? I want that then, first of all, the scream is coming, and the scream is already coming because I have already defined it here with this collision box here. Let me open eyes. I have selected this collision box here. I click edit. It opens, And we have talked about this collision box. This is one of our collision box, which is very nice. We use here the starter table, and depends on the tag of the collision box. We have talked about it. That's why it's so nice. I will just use the data, right? That was this tag system. In this case was, I don't know, scream? Nope. Let's see. There are different kind of tags. Scream sound. Okay, here's a scream sound. Let's see if I have a scream sound there. Scream sound. And you can see here is a tag. And if this collision box has this scream sound tag, we have talked about this. You can see that was our tag system. Then this one will activate, because if it has not this tag, because the same collision box here, that's the same collision box here I used here in my other places. You can see here, for example, here, this overlap here, this other one, this box here is also one of this collision box, but this one has the tag, I think, find lighter or something. Yeah, find lighter. That was the same place here, but depends on this tag, and tag means just depends on the name. It will select one of this one, and then we use the data table, which I talked already in one of my other videos, which is nice, and I can use it. But here we have a problem. And what is the problem here at this place? I want to do something. I want now implement a system how the sound is reacting to my footsteps, right? Here is just the activation point. So I need this place for the activation point. We will talk about this later a little bit more in detail. But important is now I need a system who reacts to the footstep. And this system, it's like I said, now you can use your own creativity. I used one fast prototyping. I don't know if this is really the best one. I just come up with this app and tested it. And like prototype, you test it. If it works, you are happy. If it not works, you just make another prototype or other solution. And in my case, what I come up with is, I said, okay, here, first of all, what you have to do is find the move steps. I mean, so the input, right? That was also not so easy. How you find in your horror engine, for example, the move steps. Actually, that was good. Here was this, there is a horror engine character, which I'm using. So you get here the horror engine game mode I use in this gameplay. I use this one. And the horror engine game mode has by default pawn class is this horror engine character. And interesting is if you open this one up here, double click it, and here in the event graph, they implemented the movement. But careful, this is movement, but the horror engine has also input. Let me go here to the horror engine game mode, click on this one, open up this one here. And why I say careful is horror engine game mode, that was not the part which I want to talk right now, not the game mode, sorry. There is actually this here, the horror engine, this one. This horror engine, they have a special file here, this one here, this horror engine. And this horror engine file, actually, you can see, has here many functions defined and many graphs. And they have also here a input and movement graph. So they have implemented in different places different things. You have to find the right thing. In my case, I needed just the character movement. So that was lucky. First, I checked this one here and no, there was not the character movement. And later I found, the character movement was indeed in the character itself. Makes also sense because the character is moving. Then you should put the movement as close as possible. But sometimes you are putting it not here because you want to do it, for example, I don't know, sometimes no movement you put normally in character movement, but there are parts which you don't want to put here, which are more important for online games where the server should have control, something like that. But anyway, that's important that you find this place. In my case, the solution is I need the movement because, like I said in my explanation here, my character walks in, the first sound comes, and then every time he moves, the our monster worm realize the waves, the step waves. And after, let's say, 10 steps, he will move too, because he found your direction. But he can only react to waves. And let's say you are stopping here, then there are no waves, so he can't locate you exactly point. That's why we are pretending that the worm is stopping too, to try to realize your position again. Something like that, right? Like in a submarine, a sonar system, right? They do something similar. They have a sonar system. They can realize only if there is something, and yeah, similar, something like that. All right, you understand it, I hope. So the point is now, I have all time when I move here, I have to implement this. How I implement this? In my case, I said, okay, let's try this. First of all, what I make is I have to find a way to count my moves. So let's start with this part first. I need a move counter. What I mean here is every time I make a step, I won't count this, because like I said, after let's say 10 steps, but you can change the step value, after 10 steps the worm is realizing my position after 10 steps, and then he will make the sound and move towards this position which the worm realized. And this counter system is very simple. We create just a variable. What I did is here, I go here to the right side, plus create a variable. I called it worm sound counter, because it's a little bit wrong name. Sorry, this is not worm sound counter. It is step sound counter. The worm is reacting to the sound, but let's call this step sound counter for worm. For the worm, but step sound counter makes more sense. Well, let's try to find a better naming here. So this is the steps which I make as a player, and the worm will react to this one. That's why for worm, not for me, for the worm. But I make the steps as a player. So, and here it's very simple. You create this variable, then you make it an integer or what you like, but normally an integer means just full numbers. So we make here full numbers. Then I show you that after you created this variable, of course, don't forget all time to compile. Then you just grab it, get it, and we make just a adding. You know, then you write here add, because we will all time multiply when I move. That's why we have this add function here. Add means, this normal add in math, which is just adding one. It's like a plus symbol. Careful, you can see here a different kind of adds. Here is a map, add, array, app, not this kind of stuff. Just write here plus, then it finds the right add. This add, because there are many adds, and here is just this plus add, right? So because the other add means more, you are adding it to a map, which means you are putting in a map and something. This is not the add. This here is just plus, which means we use the math add. All right, with that said, you can add, and I said then, okay, here the value is just every time this add function is called, I make one step. So in my view, every time I press forward, I make one step and then I add. But actually this is very hard implemented. I'll show you this is not easy implemented here in this case in a moment, but let's finish this one first. So here I add, and of course don't forget this counter which we get, we have to set, right? So we set this one, because I get it first, I increment it, and now I add it back to this one, the new value. That's why, and this is just my add function, and that's it. And this one here is just a test. But this one here, what you see, is just for test purposes. This one is absolutely not needed. But I still keep it so we can see a little bit the steps. That's very nice. That's why I made it here. So this was this part here. This one is test. Test means just print text or print string. It's the same thing. And then it prints out here. Let me show you what I made here. You can just write here print string. And then you can just connect here this output here. It is this one is just a converter. It means it converts the integer to a string. That's okay. And this test means it prints out on the screen the numbers, the step values here, which I count. And yeah, that's it. And then I continue this one. But we are not finished. Before, that was just our counter. That is my step counter. I count now when I press forward. But let's see what happens here before I can count. This is, I have to call the counter. And the question is, okay, how I call this counter now? Because I have just created a counter when I, and my idea is when I press forward that I should count. All right, let's go into this one. And this one is a special step. That's why it is there. Let's go here in this step a little bit. And here I said, okay, this counter must be checked. And we are back here to the movement, which I said normally you have here something like this. It is connected here. This one, all this kind of stuff here, I added. This is my special, special solution. So, but what I did here is, first of all, this is the move forward. When you press your forward key, this one you find in your project settings, like you have defined it, or in this case, it was defined by the Horror Engine, but you can go here to project settings, and click project settings and input. Where is our input? I'm blind again, like all time. Here is engine, here is input, and here in input, there is a press forward anywhere. Let's see, forward K anywhere. Here's a forward K. So you can see they this Horror Engine has defined a lot of Ks actually. And A is also the move for right. Move. This is move right, for example. This and interesting is don't get irritated. It says here move right, but you see AD, which is normally left, right? D would be, A would be left and D would be right, normally. And the reason for that is this is one axis and this is the implementation way. And the same goes for forward. If you press forward, it should be WS anywhere here. Do you see anywhere WS? I'm going probably in the wrong direction like all the time. Yeah, probably. Here is W and S. Here is move forward. It was just below, above it. I'm so blind. All right. Anyway, here you can see it again. S is down, minus, and forward is here. And this one is connecting later. This one not. Is here. Will be called here. And you can see here the name. Input axis move forward. The project setting says exactly the same here. This one is just a special name which the Horror Engine gave him. It says HA for Horror Engine and then move forward. You can see HA move forward. And this in front is just the own thing that is input access. But this one is this place. So we found the place. That's good. This is the place. And when I press now my W, which means forward, let me show you here. So I press forward. Then my counter, that is that what I just created, this one should activate. With other words, normally what I have at this point is here. So when I press forward, this one is activated, right? When I press forward, this one, counts, but let's see what happens if I make it without what I have here. That should be work too, I think. Let's see. I start this one, and anyhow, I have a problem there. Okay, there is something wrong in general. That was not good. So that's not very working. But this is our normal state. So here is the next step is. I have here is a axis value. And what is this axis value again? Let's go to project settings. The axis value says when you press W and the axis value is 1, I will move forward. So if this is not 1, I will do nothing, which means you have not pressed move forward. And if you press S, for example, this is backwards, is minus 1, then I will move backwards. Let's go here and check this out. So with other words, if I press here this move forward key, then it will react. And that's why it was strange that this, this, but anyway. So this one, when I press it, and then I can check here the value. You can see here, I check the value. I just grab it out. I make here an equal sign, and you can find here this equal. And then I say, okay, if this is one, and by the way, I just realized that I made a mistake because I, not a big mistake, but a big, it's a mistake. I check only for move forward in my code here. I have never checked for move backwards, because backwards is a move too, which means I have make here or state, something like or here. Let me show you what I missed here at my code. I have of course write minus one too. And why I have to write minus one? Let's go here to the project setting, because minus one means I walked back. Right, you can see I have only checked if forward, then activate my condition here. And I have to check backwards too. So if it's zero, for example, which means I have pressed nothing. So I have missed this step, but now I add this. And here I can show you how you can add these two conditions now. So what you do now? Now I have two conditions which I want check, and these two conditions will react to this with this branch. And if one of this condition is true, this branch should go true. That's it, right? But how we can check this? And I hope you know this logical getter, logical operators. There are different operators. I think around five, six, but not too many. And important is that you choose the right one, and here the logical OR you need. And OR means in short OR boolean. Let's make this OR, this or this. In short, OR means just if one of this one is right, I will activate this here. I will set this to true. But if both are wrong, then I will go to false. But in all other cases, I will activate it. But that's strange in this case, right? What is if both are activated? This one would go here to true, but in our case, both can't be activated, normally not activated, because the condition, let me show you this one, I can't press forward and backward. At least you can try on the keyboard to press forward and backward at the same time, but your keyboard will only accept one condition, right? Normally, this one is also not really the right logical operator. I think there was another logical operator which is just accepting either of them, but this OR will work here too. The other operator was, I don't know. There was one more which is just accepting one of them must be the opposite, and then it's up accepting. You can check it anything with exclusive or inverse exclusive or something like that, but that's not important at this point, because this all will work anyway, because you can't activate this. But probably I check this OR else, so I have just check it on Wikipedia which logical getter this one operator this one was. All right, so and then after you have this one, this, I created here a branch. The question is here, wait a minute, why you created here a branch at this point at all? The point is here to create a branch. Let's make this one here. Okay, that looks a little bit bad. Let's make it so that looks a little bit better. The reason why I created here a branch is because I want check this condition here. That's the reason. That was this branch. This branch is needed for checking this condition, and this branch is checking if I have pressed it or not pressed it. So with other words, in short, if I have pressed here, I'm playing, right? If I press, you can see my camera is moving forward. Moving forward means I press the W key. Moving backwards means I press the S key, and move and pressing nothing, no, not W and not S, means I staying at my point where I am. I'm not moving. I can only move with my mouse around, but not move forward and backwards, right? This is exactly this thing what I have covered at this point. And this branch is just checking that if you have pressed the K move forward and pressed the K backwards. If so, then normally I can check here after this point my counter, because I say, okay, if you have pressed, let's make this one. If you have pressed the forward key or the backwards key, I will count, and let's test this. I don't know why the other one was not working, but you can see on the left side on top, you see a little number. Now I press forward this W key, and there is still a problem. You can see the problem is when I press it, it's very fast. You can say it is super, super fast. So there is another problem, but it works. That's the good news. But there is a problem. And the problem actually is, yes, this axis value interval here works when you press it just short. I think it reacts in milliseconds or nanoseconds, and after a little press you have 10, 20, 30 values there, and now you have to find a way to, let's say, break it down. There are different, probably there are some nodes which can break it down. I don't know it because I just want to test it. And in the next video, I show you how I did it. It was very, actually, I can show you here. What I did it was simply said, okay, when I press the key, let's show you here again. I press
let's
the key,
see if I find this
part it's here. Too much, but I can see, I show you again, I press it just short, very short, so one, not even 1 second. That was not even 1 second, that was around, around 300 milliseconds. This was around 300 milliseconds, and I have there six. So I said, okay, around 10, I get 10. In 300 milliseconds, about 300 milliseconds, I have some steps. That means I don't allow you to go to make a steps every 300 milliseconds. And you can see I just added here a delay. That was my simple solution. A delay means here, I said, okay, if I press here and I just, you have all time wait 0.5, that's in 500 milliseconds, and then you count it as one step. So all the numbers which you saw before this will not count. And after, I don't know how many steps this 500 milliseconds is, will count. And you can see, let's make this one without this one. This is just activation. And let's do this one here. Let's start it.
Let's see if
okay,
I find
I press
cultist.
W again. One, two, and you see, let me explain what I do again. Sorry. So I press now. One. I press and stop now. I press now, and you can see the delay is there, and it caused that I count very slow now. Right? And this delay made the trick in my case. And yes, this is the part here, actually, that was here the part. We will talk about this sequence in the next, because the sequence is here to explain this part. And in the next video, I will explain this part. But I hope you get the understand what I'm trying to do. I just try to find a system there, which is counting my footsteps, and then the worm will react to this one. All right. And if you have any questions, then, like all time, write it in the comment sections. And in the next video, I continue to explain the other parts, which should be faster. And yeah, see you there. Bye. Good luck.